It's so funny because when I was a kid, I mean, I was four when the first movie came out, and the whole hellhounds. I didn't understand what a scare comedy was. All I saw was this. All I got was scared.
Okay. Yeah. Same.
So when I kind of like steered away from it, but then when the animated series came out, I became a diehard fan. It slowly built about these three guys who opened up a business, and then they're facing a 100-foot marshmallow man at the end of the movie. The second one, I actually saw in the theaters, and you know, it was just nice seeing them put the band back together and facing Vigo and making the Statue of Liberty move. A lot of the diehard fans don't like the second one for whatever reason. I love the second one. I have a custom dyed GB2 suit that I did. I wear my GB2 suit more than the tan one because everybody has a tan one. I'm proud of my gray suit. I'm open-minded for the reboot. Personally, I don't think they needed to reboot it. I think they could have just sequelized it. Mm-hmm. I think that it would have been good to see, it's 25, 26 years later. Oscar would be a grown man by now, so it would have been nice.
He could have been in the Ghostbusters now.
And you could have, like, men and women, extreme Ghostbusters show us that you can have a co-ed. I mean, one of the guys is in a wheelchair. Mm. You barely have to start from scratch.
Yeah. Well, I kind of like, I feel sort of the same. I like that it's girls now. Like, it's not that I'm against that. I guess it's just like, as a faithful lover of the original movies, it's just hard to be like, okay, well, we're going to take that same thing and just give it to someone else and stick someone else in the role. It's like whenever you have like a new class or something, like in a show, and you like the characters of the original, it's just hard to sort of say, okay, well, now they get to do this. But I don't know, like, I'm kind of, like, open-minded, too. And I know that the actors that they picked are all really funny, so I'm just hoping that the humor is on point. And I don't know, like, I'm still going to see it regardless anyways. It's just nothing will ever replace the originals in my mind, but I'm allowing this to happen, I guess.
We'll always have the animated series. Mm-hmm. We'll always have the originals. Actually, yeah. Max Landis wrote a really good, interesting script treatment for Ghostbusters 3. It was really, really, really good. Egon's daughter is kind of like the main focal point. And okay. What happened? Ray is kind of loopy, kind of lost touch with reality. Venkman mm-hmm. took the money and ran. And Winston became a billionaire.
Oh. That sounds like it could have been good.
Well, it all starts with flight suits.
Okay.
This is a true spec flight suit.
Okay, I'm gonna write this down.
You can get it off of. There are different. Outlet, Rothko makes flight suits, true spec. This is a true spec. You can get it off of Amazon for about $50 tops.
Sweet.
The patches.
Yeah.
Patches you can get off of Etsy. I got my patches off of Etsy.com.
Okay.
Her name is Katara 88. Her name is Katara.
Okay.
A lot of us in the Ghostbuster world know about her. She does great. She does good patches. You can get your she does personalized name patches. So here's mine.
Yep.
Rogers.
Cool.
So that's the flight suit.
Okay.
That's the basic.
And then you got like proton pack and stuff too, right?
Yeah. Yeah. This is my GB2 flight suit.
Cool.
I custom dyed this myself because they didn't have this color anywhere. That took about a day. That was really interesting. I never dyed anything in my life, and I'm just so happy that it came out. Same patches from the same person, but this is a GB2. Because that's what they wore in the second one. They had the GB2 patch, no ghost patch. Here is the trap. This is a few years ago. Mattel came out with a Ghostbuster replicas for the trap, the goggles, and the PKE meter. This is the trap, and it actually put this. With this toggle switch right here, and it lights up, and here's the pedal part, and it actually opens up, and you hit it again, and
that's the ghost going in.
The ghost goes in. And you give it a second, it actually like flickers, like the ghost is trying to get out.
Oh, nice. So that was just Mattel, so that's like a toy. You just bought that, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
When I started putting my suit together, I totally missed the trap was sold out on the site, so I had to go on eBay and get it.
Okay. Is that a lot?
Yeah, it was about $300.
Oh, okay, but worth it.
Yeah, but here's the PKE meter.
Okay. That's awesome. Mhm. I'd be afraid if that ever went off by itself.
Yeah. And the coup de grace.
No, proton pack.
The proton pack. Well.
Nice.
Well, hold on.
Oh, it's heavy, right?
Yeah, it's heavy.
Yeah.
You see?
Yeah, it's good. Okay. Like 50 pounds or something?
No, it's about 30.
Okay. Oh, cool. Yeah, because I know when I put that one on that your friend had, I almost fell over when I was wearing it.
Yeah.
Me and my knees want to buckle.
This was made by a very talented, a very talented prop maker. His name is Video Bob Mosley.
Okay.
He has a site. His name is Video Bob.
Yeah.
Bob Mosley.
Mm-hmm.
Along with making props, he's a big diehard Back to the Future fan. He does custom vehicles. He has an Ecto.
Oh, nice.
DeLorean.
He has a DeLorean.
And he makes proton packs. I asked him if he was ever going to like do the replicas of the reboot one, and he said possibly. So we'll see, because Bell is going to come out with a whole bunch of new merchandise. So we'll see what happens.
Okay.
But it's built for Tusk. That's why I love it so much. And it lights up. It has a rechargeable battery inside, so I could just plug it in. That he included with the pack. He included, it came with so much goodies. He had the charger, a certificate, and a DVD of his reality show, Screen Machines.
Okay.
So he had like four episodes that it was on. Shoot, I forget what, Reels TV. And it was just great. And he threw in a t-shirt and a Twinkie.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's Winky.
Yeah. So, Video Bob, he's awesome. Mm-hmm. Let me just sit this down.
I'll have to get on there and check out the next future stuff too. That's for sure. Okay.
Yeah. So.
Is that all the props?
This is the Mattel came up with the Maddie wand.
Mm-hmm.
So what he did was he took the prop and hooked it up to his pants. So now, can you hear it?
Yeah, cool.
Okay, and it extends.
Oh.
And you just, come on.
Sounds like a vacuum.
Yeah.
Well, I guess it is a vacuum.
Trying to get it to shoot. Oh.
Cool.
Yeah, it's loud. It's really loud. It has an amplifier in it, and you can adjust it.
That's amazing.
I actually met Harris Yulin, who played the judge in Ghostbusters 2.
Okay.
When I was working at Banana Republic, but he was looking for something, and I really didn't talk to him about Ghostbusters 2. I talked to him about this episode of Star Trek Deep Space Nine that he did.
Okay.
That was very emotional, that really, and I told him about that, but yeah, I was like, yeah, that's the judge from Ghostbusters 2, the Scolari brothers. Yeah. We met, I forget his name, last Halloween, this past Halloween.
Yeah.
The actor who played Dean Yeager, who booted them out of Columbia from the college. We met, he lives in Dana Barrett's the high rise. Here's a picture of fucking.
Yeah, I can see.
Yeah, see, there I am in my GB2 suit.
Okay.
I love my GB2 suit.
Yeah.
This is something where each of the characters brings something different.
Yeah.
Egon is kind of like the brain, logic. Mm-hmm. Ray brings, you know, heart and his enthusiasm.
Mm-hmm.
For ghost busting. Ernie, you know, keeps things grounded, and you know, Venkman's the wise ass.
Yeah.
You know, the four of them together, you know, it's comedy magic. So to say like, well, who's your favorite one, would almost be kind of like to diminish the other three to me. You know,
yeah.
I like them together.
Mhm. Fair point. I think I've kind of always been an Egon fan, and I think it's because usually when I see, like even with Ninja Turtles and stuff like I like Donatello, I always kind of gravitate to the one that sort of does like the gadgets and stuff like that, I guess. And
yeah.
So, and like the kind of like dry humor and stuff.
Yeah.
I also, well, I consider the Keymaster kind of an unofficial Ghostbuster, and I just like how eccentric and weird he is, so. I'll go with him too as another one.
Yeah.
And I think with the new one coming out, I'm kind of gravitating to, like, I've seen just like little bits of each of them, and I think I'm gonna like Kate McKinnon.
Yeah, everybody, I think that she's gonna steal it, because her character just seems to be
interesting.
That quirky, smart, but you know, smart,
cool.
Honky, feisty, feisty one.
Yeah, because I think the other ones, like when I look at Kristen Wiig, I see Kristen Wiig. I don't see like a character yet. And then same with like the other, like Melissa McCarthy and Leslie Jones, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
so I know what you mean.
See them as them, but I don't know. Kate McKinnon, she just makes the SNL thing. She takes on like Justin Bieber, Ellen, like whatever. She just always nails it. So it's like, I don't know. I'm that's my early prediction anyways.
It's so funny because when I was a kid, I mean, I was four when the first movie came out, and the whole Hellhounds. I didn't understand what a scare comedy was. All I saw was this. All I got was scared.
Okay. Yeah. Same. When I was young.
Yeah. So when I kind of like steered away from it, but then when the animated series came out, I became a diehard fan. It slowly built about these three guys who opened up a business, and then they're facing a 100-foot marshmallow man at the end of the movie. The second one, I actually saw in the theaters, and you know, it was just nice seeing, you know, seeing them put the band back together and facing Vigo and making the Statue of Liberty move. A lot of people, a lot of the diehard fans don't like the second one for whatever reason. I love the second one. I have a custom dyed GB2 suit that I did. I wear my GB2 suit more than the tan one because everybody has a tan one. But I'm proud of my gray suit. I'm open-minded for the reboot. Personally, I don't think they needed to reboot it. I think they could have just sequelized it. Mm-hmm. I think that it would have been good to see, like, half, I mean, it's 25, 26 years later. Oscar would be a grown man by now, so it would have been nice.
He could have been in the Ghostbusters now.
And you could have, like, men and women, extreme Ghostbusters show us that you can have a co-ed. I mean, one of the guys was in a wheelchair. Mm. You apparently have to start from scratch.
Yeah, well, I kind of like, I feel sort of the same. I like that it's girls now. Like, it's not that I'm against that. I guess it's just like, as a faithful lover of the original movies, it's just hard to be like, okay, well, we're gonna take that same thing and just give it to someone else and stick someone else in the role. It's like whenever you have like a new class or something, like in a show, and you like the characters of the original, it's just hard to sort of say, okay, well, now they get to do this. And but I don't know, like, I'm kind of like open-minded too. And I know that the actors they picked are all really funny, so I'm just hoping that the humor is on point. And I don't know, like, I'm still gonna see it regardless anyways. It's just, nothing will ever replace the originals in my mind, but I'm allowing this to happen, I guess.
We'll always have the animated series, mm-hmm. We'll always have the originals. Actually, yeah. Max Landis wrote a really good, interesting, script treatment for Ghostbusters 3. It was really, really, really good. Egon's daughter is kind of like the main focal point. And okay. What happened? Ray is kind of loopy, kind of lost touch with reality. Venkman mm-hmm. took the money and ran. And Winston became a billionaire.
Oh. That sounds like it could have been good.
Well, it all starts with the flight suit.
Okay.
This is